I became that person. I wanted to be beautiful like my mother. I wanted to be untouchable like my mother. I didn't want you to get too close to me because you...
This is Blair Durham with Black Wall Street Today, your media hub for all things Black entrepreneurship, politics, news, and events in Hampton Roads and beyond.
When I say Black, y'all say Wall Street. Black
Wall Street.
Black Wall Street. When I say Black, y'all say Wall Street. Black. Black.
Okay, so I'm going to introduce our speaker. We are in for a treat today, as if the food was not enough. We have Ms. Benita Adams with us. She is a successful TV and radio host, communication coach, author, and motivational speaker. She's worked in the media and communications field for over 30 years. For a decade, she worked at the Emmy Award-winning WBEC Channel 13 News. I found out she was the helicopter traffic girl. Do y'all remember that? The very first one, right? She is the host and producer of the radio show Hampton Roads Voices on WNSB Hot 91. It's a live call-in show and includes in-studio guest experts. She discusses important issues and solutions that affect the Black community and beyond. As a communication coach, she uses proven strategies to help people get their ideas and message across clearly and effectively. Something everybody in the room said they needed some assistance with. Her clients gain confidence by working on both verbal and written skills. Her passion is helping baby boomers and middle-aged women 50 years and older in their midlife journey of transformation and reinvention. That's all I'm going to share. Benita's going to tell the rest of her incredible story. Some of you all may have heard her this past week on Black Wall Street Today. She was amazing. Welcome, welcome. So raise your hand again. Let me see the people who are just getting ready to start your business. I heard everybody. I think there were at least five or six people getting ready to start a business. Okay, just one or two just getting ready to start. I love that you said that you weren't a public speaker, and then you said, oh, forget it. I'm just going to claim it. I'm just going to claim that I'm a public speaker. I love that. And that's so important. That's so important. So when I was asked to come out today and we were talking about engaging our audience, I'm going to do a little bit of a spin on, a little bit of spin on public speaking. And I want to debunk a couple of myths about public speaking. First of all, we have to understand that words are powerful. Can you agree with me on that? Words are so powerful. Words can build up and create, and words can tear down and destroy. I remember an artist, she actually happened to be a Christian artist, and she said that when she was 8 years old, she happened to come down the steps and her parents were talking to one another. And she didn't hear anything before this, but when she came downstairs, she heard her father say, I think she is one of the most unattractive, ugliest girls I've ever seen. She said, and her father and her mother didn't even know she was standing there. They didn't know that she overheard it. Again, she didn't hear anything up until that point until she heard her father say that. And she said that that changed the course of her life because those words impacted her so greatly. And when we think about the power of words, words are as powerful as a blow. If somebody came and they hit you, or they punched you, or they smacked you, that hurts, right? But when they say something, when words are given to you, when words are put on you, and you, the old term, called out of your name, my mother used to say, that hurts just as much. So when we talk about engaging others and so forth, I want us to start with reminding ourselves the power of words. The Bible says the life and death is in the power of the tongue. You see how powerful that is. And we don't have to wonder sometimes why our children, when especially our brown boys, when they get to a certain point in school, they drop out. Because if you have heard from the beginning, you raise your hand, little Johnny raises his hand, she just put your hand down, you know you don't know the answer. How can you not be smart as your
He doesn't go anymore. You're talking about the pipeline to prison. Those are words that many times created those things. When mama said that to you, and daddy said that to you, and auntie said it to you, and your teacher said it to you, and your coach said it to you, we cannot haphazardly throw words around because we feel like it and say, oh, I didn't mean that. I'm just kidding. I have three kids altogether. Really, I have four children altogether. I have my son who's 31. I have my daughter who's 35. I have a 33. I have another daughter who's 35. And I have my little bonus son who is 3. And 2 weeks ago, I turned 60. But I still have a wonderful little bonus boy. And he's fantastic. And I have custody of him. And I'm loving every minute of it. Yeah, I am loving every minute of it. No, really. I told somebody, I tell a story all the time. I didn't even know they still, I didn't even know where the baby aisle was in Walmart. I'm like, they still sell stuff in Walmart? I hadn't been in 30 years, so I didn't even know where the baby stuff was. So I'm in the process right now at 60 of potty training. I said, didn't I do this? I never did this already. And yet, I'm still potty training. Wow, you don't even know the direction your life is going sometimes, and yet we still continue. And so I say that to say that I, of my two daughters, the 35-year-old and the 33-year-old, they're very different. When I first had them, when I first had my first child, somebody said, oh, you know, when you have your kids, it's going to be so challenging. And I had her, and she's a textbook case of being compliant and easy to get along with. This is nothing. I could raise this girl with my eyes closed until I had my second daughter. I went, oh my Lord, is this what they were talking about? Oh my gosh, you start reading books like How to Raise a Strong-Willed Child and Parenting Isn't for Cowards. I'm like, oh, I get it now. So I say it in these terms. My one daughter who's just really nice and, well, all my kids are nice, but she's just that type. She doesn't want to hurt anybody's feelings. And my other one, well, they're always going to be honest. You know what I'm saying? I'm just telling them how it is, and I'm like, mom. And so I would go, yeah. And so my oldest girl, who's the really the different kind, she would say something unkind, but she'd laugh. I'm just playing. I don't mean that. And the other one would say, I'm going to tell you to your, I'm going to tell you. I'm like, whoa, but they're both saying the same thing, but saying it differently, right? So words are so powerful. And we know that words can direct the course of our lives. We know words can change. Words change us, because if we constantly say, I can't, who, me? Oh, no, not me, her, yeah, not me. That's going to get into our spirits, right? And we're going to start to believe we can't. But when we say, I can, I will, it's possible, I'm going to do it, I'm moving forward, I'm reinventing, I'm changing my life, then we start to believe it, right? You know, maybe I can do this thing. And so we know words are so, so powerful. And we also know, as I said, I'm going to debunk a myth a little bit about how the framework in which we're looking in terms of public speaking. But when we think about this, I don't want to always think about in terms of public speaking in the formal sense. Because sometimes just the term public speaking makes people feel like, oh, no, not me. I'm a behind the scenes character. Don't put me out there. Don't put me, no, not me. I don't like talking to people weird. I get that. I looked up a list of the 10 greatest fears. I bet you've seen this list before. It says, some of the 10 greatest fears, flying, loneliness, death, insects, public speaking. And I just happen to do that with number 5. Do you know that people rather fly or die or be lonely than get around folks and talk? We're like, honey, let me fly. I don't even want to fly. Okay? People don't like public speaking. It makes them fearful. But again, I don't want us to think about these words that we have at our to use. Disposals, our words at a disposal, just in this behind a podium with a mic in front of a large crowd. Think about the people that we talk to every day. Think about the people in the lives that we can touch every single day.
We come to a networking event, you have to stand up. How many of you were nervous when you thought it was your turn to say, I was like, oh my gosh, I gotta say something. Okay, not bad, not bad. Or, oh, you know, so my, maybe they'll just skip over me. So a networking event, that's public speaking. You're at an event, you have to raise your hand and ask a question. That's public speaking. You're at some sort of community event. That's public speaking. All of that makes a difference. And so in business and social settings, all that's public speaking. And that's what we need to do when we engage other people. And so I love that. Even speaking one-on-one is so important. So anytime we open up our mouths, it's important to learn how to connect or talk to people. So I have 4 tips for you today. There's a whole bunch to unpack. But I'm going to have a pop-up of telling compelling stories on the 19th of September. I'll tell you more about that a little bit later. And we'll unpack all of these things. Right now I'm just going to present them to you. But we're going to be talking about how to tell your stories. We're going to talk about how to connect. We're going to be talking about how to use that language, how to present yourself. But right now, I just want to give you those 4 tips in terms of speaking with others and why it's so important. Okay, so tip number 1. This seems so simple, and it's almost like, Benita, why are you telling me this? But this is tip number 1. You are more confident when you talk about something you know about, right? That's number 1. Talk about what you know. Don't try to be this person over here, and don't try to be this person over here. It doesn't mean that we don't learn from other people. I don't mean that. It doesn't mean that we don't grow and expand. But if I talk about what I know, if I talk about my passion, doesn't it come across? You talk about, I've seen you online so many, I said, there she is. No kidding. Is that her? This is what's happening. Person. So you talk about real estate. You're passionate about real estate. So when you talk about, you're passionate about education. You're passionate about promoting events and so forth. And when I'm passionate about something, doesn't that come across? When I love it, when I am compelled to tell you about it, that's step number 1. You got to talk about what you love. You've got to talk about something that you know something about. I think about TV, that's a big term, you know, people online, you can be anywhere. What is it that people watch reality TV? Sometimes people say, I don't tell anybody I watch The Housewives. Right, I almost, so I sometimes feel embarrassed. But why do people watch reality TV shows like The Housewives and like famous people and so on? Why? You tell me. Why? Why do we watch that?
Entertainment,
absolutely.
Some people like to see train wrecks.
Okay. Exactly. Some people are train wrecks. You are not kidding. Why?
Sometimes controversy, but also wishing to be like them.
That's right. We get a glimpse behind the curtain. We get a little glimpse behind the curtain. Like, oh, I wonder how they live. I wonder how the rich and famous live. I wonder how celebrities live. I wonder. We want a glimpse behind the curtain. That's why we look at those shows. But even if we don't do the reality TV thing, why don't we follow people on social media then? And they're going to be rich or famous. Why don't we follow people on social media? It's my tone. Why? And most people do. To do what?
Sometimes it's a track and record. Interesting. People move forward.
Yes.
They do a lot of things.
They do.
You know, so you want to see what they're doing.
You want to see what they're doing. Their record, their lives, their projects can inspire us, right? Like, oh my gosh, look what she's doing. She just started her business last year. Look where she is now. She's thinking about making that change of reinvention and transformation. She's going to leave her job. She's scared. She said she's scared, but you know what? She's going to do it anyway. That makes us hopeful. It makes us say, if her, if him, what? Maybe me. Maybe I can do that. And that's why when you got up and you talked about yourselves and your goals and where you're headed, that's why that's so inspiring for us. Because you're like, yeah, that's what I want too. And so that's why. So we talk about what we're passionate about. The next thing is, I'm going to jump ahead. The next thing is, number 2, we talk about, you have to know, number 2, who you're talking to. How many millennials are in the room? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. Do you know the years of millennials? You're not quite. Millennials, I looked at, millennials are 1981 to 1996. Are you a millennial? Raise your hand if you are. Okay? Oh, 19 millennials, 1981 to 1996. 81 and 96, right here. You know what? Folks hate on millennials too much. They always feel privileged. They always feel like everything should be given to them. They don't have any concentration. All they do is stay on loud. Right there, Cruz, this us in this room, that person, that's not completely true. Are you here? You're not online. You're here. You're here. Any baby boomers in here? And let me tell you, those years, 46 to 64. Come on. Grab your hand. Inspiration to others, but I number two have to know who I'm talking to. That's important because a Gen Xer may think differently than a baby boomer, that's very different than a millennial, okay? So we have to know who we're talking to. You have to up level your language. You got to change your language. I'm going to use a really old example. My mother's 87, in really good health, still driving, and she would say, I'm in my right mind, which is nice, you know, being in your right mind at 87. My mother's really sharp. Well, my father died several years ago, and he was 78 when he passed. But one thing about that is I had to try to help my father change his language. My father said one day, you know, I'm not sure why colored people still do what they do. I said, Dad, we don't say that anymore. No, we changed that word. He said, oh, we don't say colored and Negro? I said, Dad, we don't say that anymore. Don't say that, Dad. He said, well, what should I say? And I'm trying to give him the long haul, the new terms. He's like, ah, I'm too old for that. I'm just going to call them colored. I'm like, oh, my gosh. Oh, good luck. And then when I was teaching, I taught on the college level for over 35 years, and I met a gentleman. And he was a trucker, that's the term he used. And he was probably about 65 or 67. And he used an example. He said, I met some Orientals the other day. And those Orientals, I tell you, they bring all their folks with them. I said, you know what? We don't say that anymore. He said, what? When did that change? I said, a long time ago. Don't say Oriental, just like my dad, don't say colored and Negro, okay? So we've got to up-level our language. You've got to change with the time. You've got to know who you're talking to. Because I can't connect with you if I'm using all kinds of language over here, and you become offended by me. What just happened online with our president? Because we become offended by that language. We do. I can't connect with you if I offend you by saying, using terms that you find offensive. You got to know your language. So that's tip number two. And you have to reinvent yourself with your own words. With your own words. Okay. Somebody, give me three words that describe you. Anybody? Raise your hand. Three words that describe you.
Passionate.
Purpose.
Possibility.
Somebody else, three words that describe you. Three words that are associated with you.
Focus, hopeful, dedicated.
Focus, hopeful, dedicated. One other person. Somebody, three words that describe you.
Funny. Optimistic and teachable.
Absolutely. Somebody finish the sentence. In 5 years, I will
be wealthy.
Oh, sorry. 5 years, I will
be wealthy.
Be wealthy. Oh, I love that. I'll say that to myself. In 5 years, I'm 5 years. So I was like, I like that. I'll say that all the way home. In 5 years, I'll be wealthy. Did you have your hand up? Okay. we have to reinvent ourselves. One of the sentences, I'm good at, fill in the blank, I'm good at networking, encouraging, teaching, solving problems, inspiring. You see, again, the words, we're all loving, we're reinventing. We have to, Les Brown, who's a motivational speaker, many of you probably heard him, and what Les Brown said, he tells the story of how he struggled so much with, as he called it, being given away. You know, he has a twin brother, and they were adopted at 6 months and he kept saying, I was given away, my parents gave me away, my mother gave me away, gave me away, and he struggled in anger with that until he learned that you have to redefine and change the language and how we see our past sometimes. And so he said somebody, he had said that on a radio show, and a friend called him, and the friend said, when women have babies, they carry those babies for 9 months. He said, but your mother, Mamie Brown, picked you out of love. She didn't birth you, but she picked you out of love. And he said, from that point on, he stopped saying, I was given away. He said, I was chosen. You see how you redefine the future? It's the same thing, but you see it differently. It gets into your spirit differently. You see yourself and your life and your future and your possibilities differently, because now I'm just not a hopeless person, and I'm just a caution to the wind. My father was an orphan as well. My father was born in 1932. My mother was born in 1933. Do you know what America looked like in the 30s and 40s and 50s for blacks? Do you know how tough it was? My father, his mother died. He was the third. His mother died when he was born. His father, he didn't know who his father was at all. He was a ward of the state. And as a ward of the state during the 30s and 40s, they loaned you out to white families. They loaned him out to work for white families and did not feed him. He had to wear the hand-me-downs of the state. And yet, he was able, really through being my father's minister, and he was able, through the help of God, to redefine that future. His sister struggled so hard with that story. His brother struggled even more so with that story. But my father ended up a wealthy man. Wealth in terms of love from his family. Wealth in terms of the church. Wealth in terms of inspiring and changing others. Not wealth in terms of money. He had some. We were a working class family. And yet he had to reshape his past and the language that he used. We have to do that. First of all, we all have problems and situations. My show, Hampton Rose Voices, I've done several shows on children without knowing their dads. It's hard if you grew up and you never even knew your dad. I do some teaching over in Norfolk State. He said he was the oldest of 15. And his father, he never even knew who his dad was, but he knew that he was oldest of 15. He knew that. And he said for a long time, he was so angry with his father. He was so angry with him. How could you leave mom like that? So we've got to readjust, and we've got to change those words. That's number two. Number three. So number one, talk about what you know about and what you're passionate about. Number two, you need to change the language and know who you're talking to. Number three, you've got to tell compelling stories. That's a part of what this boot camp, Papa Boot Camp, is going to be about. Telling compelling stories. And stories are so important. And sometimes it isn't just the product or the service we need to talk about. We need the people to gravitate to our story. How did you start that business? What were the sacrifices? What did you need to do? How did you interact? When you were discouraged, what did you do? How did you network and communicate with other people? It isn't just the product or service. Of course, that's very important. But they connect with you. You know that saying, people do business with people they like, know, and trust. We heard that over and over again. But they need to hear your story. With the clients that I work with, and the second act, and my communications aspect of the second act, I'm working with a particular lady. She owns she does commercial and residential real estate. And when she first started the business, there were very few women in that field. I mean, it's still not as many women in that field. And so I asked her, I said, what's your story? And she said she was a single mom, and she had two girls. And she had dropped out of high school, and she never went to college. And she wanted more for her girls than she had when she was growing up. And so I connect with her story, and other people who hear her story connect with that. Not just that, yes, I'm successful now, but walk it backwards. Who were you back then when you were a teenage mom? When you decided that you had to drop out of high school, that you decided not to go to college, that you decided to move from one field to the next and move into a more of a male-dominated field. We're compelled by yourself. What is your story? We want to know your story. That's what we want to know. And it's so important that you're able to tell your stories and tell us what motivated you and to tell us how the problems that you had perhaps helped you devise a plan and a business to solve the problems of others. It says that in business or entrepreneurs, they solve problems for people. They solve problems. So is there a connection there? So you've got to tell us your story. And many women, as I'm going out and speaking, I hear them say, I want to change. I want to change. I've been a nurse for 35 years. I'm working with a client now. She said, I've been a nurse for 35 years, and I love being a nurse. But I want to do something different. I want to change. I want to reinvent. I want to go in another direction. And so all of that is very, very important. And the fourth and last tip, is speak from your heart. Guys, when you speak from your heart, we connect with you. That's when we connect. We speak intellectually. That's wonderful. I'm an educator, so I know how important education is. But when you're open and humble and vulnerable and sincere, that's when we connect with you. When you tell us something. Now, one of the things about public speaking, whether, again, it's public speaking formally, whether it's public speaking when I'm talking one-on-one with someone, whether it's in a meeting or something, people connect with your humanity. I read once that the Kennedys, now this might, the numbers might have changed since I read this, but it said that the Kennedy line, almost everyone starts at birth with $1 million. They start. Come on. You got the Kennedy name, you got $1 million, and you what, a month? Oh, what? How can you almost not go up from there, right? So one thing about public speaking is, you've got to tell your truth. And when you tell me your story, and it's very vulnerable to tell your story. I tell about in the book, I call this one section in here, I call it kitchenware. And the reason I call it kitchenware is because I tell the story about my father and my mother. And when I was growing up, my mother was so beautiful. She looks nice to be 87, but when she was in her 30s, she was gorgeous. Okay, I'm going to describe her to you and tell you something about my dad. My mother was extremely shapely, had beautiful legs, soft, soft, light skin. Here I go. And good hair. Okay, she needs to do this again. Even millennials know what I mean when I say good hair, right? And my dad used to say, your mother is so beautiful. Your mother, just look at her. Look at her. She's so... My mother was my father's trophy. And I'll tell you in all honesty that my mother was the closest thing that my father could get to a white woman. And that is the truth. He couldn't get a white woman, but he got this light-skinned woman with good hair. And he paraded her. And she'd dress up and wear her little gloves. And there's nothing wrong with that. And her little hats and her outfits. But my father was just so proud of her. So when I read the section in the book about kitchenware, I said for me, as I said, you got to be open and vulnerable and genuine and sincere. Inside of me, I was torn. Because I was very proud that I had a beautiful mother. But there was another part of me that went, really, Dad? Really? And I'll tell you something that's going to make my dad look really horrible. He was a great man, but he said this to me once. He said, look at your mother. She's not one of them big bone, dark skinned, nappy headed women. She's beautiful. So what does that say to us? That you're not beautiful. Wait a minute. You got to look like my mama to be beautiful? Dark skin, big bone, nappy hair. I'm so upset. I forget. she was very cold. My mother was very isolating. She was not warm. And I'll tell you, my mother didn't, I didn't even hear my mother say, I love you, until probably when I was like 45 and I finally said it to her. Oh yeah, I do love you. And so I said that I became the person that wanted to be, you know how you go to a museum and all those beautiful things are in the glass case, and you go up to the glass case and you touch it, you can't really touch it, but you can admire it. I became that person. I wanted to be beautiful like my mother. I wanted to be untouchable like my mother. I didn't want you to get too close to me because you see my flaws and my weaknesses and my frailties and my mistakes. I would not allow people to get close enough to me. And then I said, you know what? I don't want to be good China anymore. What's the good China? You only take it out in the holidays. Don't let the kids touch it. Don't put it in the microwave because it's good chip. And that came from my grandma. And you bet, I want to be kitchenware. My life has to be kitchenware now. What's kitchenware? I let my little 3-year-old touch the kitchenware. This place we eat up now, some kids in here, they're using the kitchenware. The stuff you use, you use on a daily basis. You throw it in the microwave and you use it again. I'm kitchenware now. I'm no longer the good China. It's okay. Lisa Nichols is a transformational coach, says she has so learned to perfectly manage her imperfections. And we better know that, yeah, we all have a public persona, I get that. But we know that there's some things about us that we all need to change. And so it's okay to be transparent when you're speaking. I don't mean to tell all your business, no, I don't know that. But, like, girl, let me tell you about what happened last night. I don't want to know that. But it's okay to be real and human and vulnerable. It's okay because somebody that I'm talking to, they needed to hear that today. They needed me to say, wow, you look wonderful today. Really? This old thing, girl, I just got this from the Google for $5. It's okay, it still looks good. It's okay to be human and to show that I'm a real person talking to real folks, okay? And so you've got to be able to do that as a speaker. Maya Angelou says, people won't remember what you've heard this quote before. They won't always remember what you said or what they did. But it's how you make them feel. It's how, when I leave your presence, whether it's a large group, a small group, a one-on-one, how did you feel when we were together? How did I use these powerful words to change the course, maybe even of your life? And as I give out, don't we get back? We get back. Somebody says, oh my gosh, I need to care today. I was having a hard day. And you feel, God, thank you for that today. Thank you that I was in the right place at the right time with the right message, with the right person, that I could fulfill part of my destiny today. And that's the power of these words that we're talking about. So when I say engaging your audience, when I say connecting and using these powerful words, I charge you today to don't be afraid of that. Get out there. As Lisa Nichols says, knees knocking and teeth chattering. I'm going to fulfill this assignment. I don't like this public speaking stuff, but I'm going to do it anyway. I don't want to get up and say anything about myself. I don't particularly like to network, but you know what? Whoever you needed to talk to was there that day and had to be there. So I challenge you, use your words, which are power. They can change your life. They can change somebody else's life because words make a difference. Thanks, guys.
Stay with us online at Black Wall Street Today on Facebook and Black Wall Street Today on Instagram. And then follow us on Twitter as well at BWS Today. We look forward to talking again next week. Have a wonderful week. I have said and I will continue to say that the most important priority for the Black community is the Black community, not a particular political party. phenomenal.